I'd like to talk about love. And let's start with something from my family. This is the wedding picture of my great-grandparents. And these are not pictures of my wedding, but those are typical photos taken by wedding photographers. What makes these pictures different? What differentiates the how and why behind choosing a partner between then and now? Today, people marry for love. And because we actually believe that people who marry should be in love with each other, also same-sex marriages are socially acceptable and legally binding. Because if we believe in love, we can hardly oppose a bond that is established by love. In the past, there were so-called marriages of convenience. That means people joined or were joined in hope of benefiting of special interests and of reasons of security. A son and heir, social status, providing for old age, and maybe to uphold family lineage. Love may have been a many splendid thing, but it was secondary, and it was even taboo in those societies where love was considered security risk number one in a marriage. And today, of all things, love, this infamous, fickle, four-letter word, is supposed to give us security. We want a relationship to make us feel safe. And to achieve this, we need nothing less than the perfect partner, a match made in heaven for lifelong passion. Esther Perel once said, "So we meet this one single person and we expect them to give us everything we once needed a whole village full of people to get. We need the chosen one and we want them to last forever. The AM, PM, 24/7 forever partner. He is passionate lover, BFF, soulmate, shoulder to cry on, jogging buddy, sparing partner, father or mother of our children. Everything wrapped up in one neat package." As a counselor for couples, I know firsthand how overwhelmed and stressed people sometimes feel when they try to maintain a relationship that is built on equality, respect, and mutual understanding. In my experience as a singles coach, I encounter an even greater number of individuals who are totally overwhelmed and stressed by just seeking a partner. The reason for that being, when the bar is set so high, the decision itself is becoming overwhelming and particularly difficult. And it breeds fear. We are afraid to mess up. And when we look at the ever-growing number of relationships we enter into in our lives, we get the feeling we are constantly messing up. Every relationship goes wrong means we have made a bad choice. We have failed. Every date goes wrong means we have made a poor choice. We have failed. And when yet another attempt of relationship is terminated after 3 months or 6 weeks of dating, then we have once again built our relationship house on sand. We have failed. And every time we fail, our self-esteem hits just another blow. Each and every one of us today has more relationships than our parents, our grandparents, and our great-grandparents ever had. But the more relationships we enter into, the more breakups we experience. And every breakup means we can just our self-esteem suffers. And what happens then? Well, we run for cover and put on our armor of self-defense, which is expressed as fear of commitment and fear of loss. Proclaiming "I can't commit" is a self-protective strategy, similar to professing "I won't ever be able to trust again." And although these typical sentences serve a short-term purpose, they are once ingrained pure poison and ultimately, for many singles today, sabotage their finding a partner. As editor-in-chief of an online magazine about love. I know a lot of things that happens out there because we receive authentic love stories from our readers every day. And they all deal with the bonding system and self-esteem. Self-esteem is the cornerstone of our bonding system. And you can imagine the bonding system as a perpetual motion toy where you have on the left side fear of loss. It represents the belief, I am not worthy. I have to earn the right to be loved. People who are afraid of experiencing loss, they are attracted to people who they envision to be very strong and self-confident. And we find them on the right side, where there is fear of commitment. Those are afraid of experiencing getting too close. They think their self-esteem, their self-control is their greatest asset. They don't want to lose their self. They are afraid to get sucked into the V of a relationship and losing the me. And when they are seeking a partner, they are attracted by those who are afraid of experiencing loss. Because when they try to make a relationship, they have to make an effort to make that work. And that raises their self-esteem. It sounds like a perfect match, but it isn't. Because if they come too close, they drop them like a hot potato. This rubber band strategy is problematic when you're trying to find a partner, but it's also problematic when you're trying to remain a relationship. And Dr. Sue Johnson, the inventor of the emotional-focused couples therapy, which is based on the bonding system, she refers to that as the dance, because it's a self-propelling dynamic, and this dynamic has been increasing since the turn of the millennium. I told you that I have authentic quotes from our readers about love, because they all deal with fear of loss meets fear of commitment and vice versa. Here are some quotes. You've heard them, probably. What these sentences are saying, or rather screaming, is, I'm starving. I'm starving for security. I'm only willing to make an investment if I can be sure that the investment will pay off. A lot of things have changed since the turn of the millennium, and I'd like to talk about three of these, which I think drive the growing fear of commitment and fear of loss. First of all, there's online dating. One of the first dating apps that turned up in the millennium was called Yes, No, Maybe. Nice name, it worked like that. The singles received potential candidates and they could be rated as yes, maybe, or no. If both said yes or maybe, this was displayed and the matches could contact each other. Well, you laughed, you probably never heard about that. The platform wasn't rather successful, probably because by offering the maybe, there was one unsecure criteria too many. Because we know the concept is very, very successful. Because yes and no are quite sufficient for the most successful dating app in the world, Tinder. So it's all about security. Also, those dating apps not only promise to deliver a match, they also guarantee to deliver the best possible match, and preferably minus the frustration, because frustrated customers don't pay the bill. So the single should feel certain that the matches could work for relationship, and the single should feel as certain as possible of never experiencing rejection. It's really just about security. And the second phenomenon is the omnipresent and always accessible entertainment media. Whether the story is in a book, a movie, or in a series, Love is everywhere, even in places where it doesn't belong. For instance, in historical sagas. Evidence shows back then, love was not a topic. In Germany, we didn't even have a word for jealousy before the 16th century. So our today's fictional and scripted melodramas represent our today's, our contemporary desire for the forever partner, the ever-loving, everlasting partner. If they didn't, nobody would be watching. Okay, we know it's just Hollywood, but we really do want to believe. And when we look around, don't we see people who are actually living this dream? And that brings me to the third millennium-related innovation, and that's social media. All those love stories not only make us yearn for that forever partner, but we are thoroughly convinced that this phantom partner really exists with every picture of happy, shiny couples we see posted every day on Facebook, on Instagram, on blogs. You've all seen the couples on Instagram holding hands in the most beautiful places on earth. Here they are on Bali, there in front of the Taj Mahal, swimming, hiking, kissing. You've seen them all. You need to have a pretty strong sense of self-esteem not to think, oh, I want that too. But we actually don't use social media when we're feeling good about ourselves. We use it when we're feeling low and need a happy dopamine high. And so our negative thoughts spin into an even more downward spiral. Why can't that be me? What's wrong with me? And here we are again, challenged by our own self-esteem. Because the greater the expectations, the further the fall when they are not met. And I call this effect the Disneyfication of love. Fantasy worlds put us in a safety zone when reality makes us fearful. When you meet someone in the gym or in a cafe today, you don't approach them. You look up their profile in the internet and contact them there. You don't pick up the phone and call someone. You do other chat. We put ourselves in a safe place, cushioned by our protective strategies, just to make sure to never experience any hurt, rejection, or refusal. So where do we go from here? Well, online dating is here to stay, and that's a good thing, because since we spend so much time online, it's a blessing that we can also make contact while we are there. And on the other hand, online dating gives us a chance to meet people who we'd otherwise never encounter. And all those love stories, they won't go away. Probably not. They will continue to influence us. And the way we receive finding a partner, dating, and relationship. Unfortunately, I don't have a simple solution up my sleeve because I think there is no simple solution. But I do know that there are two paths that lead to love, and that's courage and trust. You need to have trust to be able to commit. And if you can't, because bad things happened to you in the past, please try therapy. Life is too short to spend it alone and in fear. And courage can be trained every day by just talking to people. If you're kind and open-minded, they will open up to you. Courage and trust can't be cultivated in the digital void where users are anonymous and untouchable. It can only be experienced in real contact and interpersonal exchange. And promoted by a culture that doesn't condemn failure, but celebrates it as an opportunity for improvement in the search for the healing power of love. Thank you.